fountain pens are works of art, in my opinion. Not all of them, but maybe most of them. What's cool about this is the dragon has these red, almost glowing eyes. Hey everybody. This is a beautiful car, wouldn't you say? It's called a Gurney Westlake Eagle. It's a Formula One car, as far as I know. The prototype was raced in 66, 67. Was originally introduced with a four-cylinder. But after four races, they put in a V12. It's a 3-liter V12. Pretty successful. I think it won the 67 Belgium Grand Prix, or was it the 66? I'm not sure. Doing some iRacing on my computer. I was feeling kind of racy. Now in the last video I kind of teased you. I told you that I had gotten a new pen. Well, it's in this tin. Been aware of this pen for some time. I've wondered about it. the reviews and stuff that I've read, and said it was a pretty good pen. Now, because I've had it for a few weeks, I don't remember exactly how much it cost. I'm gonna put the price on the screen right about now. Other than the pen, there wasn't anything else in the tin. The pen is made by Jinhao. And if you know anything about fountain pens, you know that Jinhao is a Chinese brand pen. It's a nice looking pen. Unlike a lot of the other Jinhaos, the cap on this one unscrews instead of just snaps on. Has a nice, dark, rich, green color to it. Then the material that it's made out of is, it's not just any kind of plastic, it's I'm wanting to say celluloid. Oh, I need a little box to put this in. I don't seem to have one handy, so we'll just bring this one out. It seems to have your standard converter in it. What can you see with that? Jinhao. It has their symbol on it. Looks like a horse pulling a chariot and a couple of people riding inside the chariot. They have the same symbol on top of the cap. Yeah, do you see that? Yeah, that's pretty cool. And the model of this is, I believe it's a Jinhao 100. Some people speculate, or they say maybe it's not speculation, maybe it's fact. I'm not sure. That this was basically a copy of a Parker Duofold. Now I have a Parker Duofold. It's a really old one. And it's not the full size, it's kind of the smaller size. So this is not a good comparison. But you can see the similarity. If I had the full-size Duofold, the clip might as, you know, it might be just as long as the clip on the Jinhao. Then the bottom of the pens. There's some similarities. And once again, on a full-size Duofold, that black piece would probably be larger than on this smaller-size Duofold. This Duofold was made in 1922 or 26, I can't remember. This was passed down to me from my grandfather, or from my dad. He got it from his dad. His dad was a Parker Pen employee. He was a tool and die maker. And out of the same material that the pen was made, my grandfather made this nice pencil lead holder. That's some very old lead. Now, of course, the Duofold pen doesn't use lead. But the matching pencil that came with a pen does. And even the pen is a thing of, the pencil's a thing of beauty. And I really do like these old Parker pencils. This 100-year-old pencil. The larger Duofold, when it came with a, you know, a larger pencil, if it came, you know, as a pen and pencil set. So here is a larger pencil. It says Parker on it right there. I really do like the color of this one. Parker. Now these Duofolds were called Big Reds. I'm not really sure why, because this is the original color and it's kind of an orange. In the early 70s, 1972, I think, Parker came out with a ballpoint pen. And they called it a Big Red also. It's supposed to be a ballpoint pen that has this styling characteristics of it as a Big Red Duofold. Now this one has kind of like a company logo on it, CFNI Steel. We can do, or can do. I've got a couple of these of the same color without the logo. Even though they're called Big Red ballpoint pens, they came in different colors. Even if it came in a green color, or a yellow, or black, or blue, it's still called a Big Red, no matter what the color. These are probably my favorite ballpoints. And as far as I know, both of these are from 1972, I guess. Let's ink up this Jinhao, or at least let's take some measurements on it first. And so the cap is about 585 thousandths of an inch. And I use Imperial because I live in the U.S. and that's what we use more than we do metric. And the barrel is a tad over a half inch. It's 510 thousandths. And the overall length is 5 inches, 421 thousandths of an inch. Somebody said they really like the sound of the caliper. Now there's other Chinese Jinhaos of similar design. Here's a Jinhao. What is this? A 500. Similar length. Not exact copies of each other, but you know, got the squared off top and squared off bottom. It's been a long time since I've used this pen. I think I'm going to put some ancient copper diamine ink in this sometime soon. Not right now, but soon. Here's a pen made by a German company named Duke. It's a similar size. This is carbon fiber up in here of different colors. Here's a brand of pen that I don't even remember the brand. Again, it's a similar size, and as is all of these, all of these pens are just inexpensive Chinese pens. Here's a Jinhao. It's a similar size. This one is called, trying to remember. It's got a real cool name. It's a dragon's offspring or something like that. I just don't remember. I'm sorry. But what's cool about this is the dragon has these red, almost glowing eyes. This pen is a good writing pen too. I like it a lot. And it's got this Chinese writing on it, and it's got a, let's see if I can show it, it's got a dragon. It's not engraved, I don't guess, but it's embossed. It's kind of hard to see that in the video. It's got a number 6 nib. Number 6 refers to the size of the nib, the physical size of the nib. And my new pen also has a number 6 nib. I guess I could try to zoom in on these a little bit. Fountain pens are works of art, in my opinion. Not all of them, but maybe most of them. The nib on the new pen it's 18 karat gold plated, and it doesn't say medium, or does it? I don't see a letter M. But I'm pretty sure it's a medium. Now, some of you are probably saying, screaming at your phone or computer, whatever you're viewing this on, to get on with it. Well, I'm kind of working at my own speed here. I'm relaxing, just relaxing. So after 30 minutes, let's go ahead and ink it up. And I thought about putting the diamine ancient copper in it, but I also thought about putting this J. Herbin green ink into it also. You don't have to shake up fountain pen ink. I just like the sound that it makes. I wished I had a Q-tip handy. You know what? I'm gonna get a Q-tip. Hold on. So I got a Q-tip. I wanted to look at the color of this ink. That's pretty nice. How does that compare with the color of the pen? It's hard to tell. Lighting. I'm using a different lighting setup in this video, but no, it's not a match. Not a match. But we're gonna use it anyhow. Now, I've washed this pen. It's never been inked, but many times I wash the pens that I get just to make sure that there's not any kind of manufacturing residue or anything on them. Unscrew the barrel. This ink converter has a piston in it. Some people might call it a plunger. You can see it right here. Yeah, right there. When I turn this, it moves the plunger up and down. So it's all the way down now, but I'm going to start with it all the way up. And I'm going to dip the pen into the ink bottle up to about here. And I'm going to turn this and make the plunger go down, forcing out any air that is in the reservoir. And once it's all the way down, then I'll draw it back up. And of course, the vacuum will cause ink to come with it. That's how you fill a fountain pen. Have a tissue close by to dab off any ink that gets on the pen. Okay, the pen is loaded with ink. We'll carefully remove any ink that is on the pen. We're going to carefully put the barrel on it. and carefully put the cap on it. And we're trying to be careful. And now, before we do anything else, we're going to put the cap back on the bottle. We don't want to spill the ink. Because if you spill a bottle of fountain pen ink, it'll ruin your day. Now this pen feels pretty good in my hand. My hand is probably an average size hand. It's not too large, not too small, just kind of average. So a larger pen feels fine in my hand. It looks like you can post this. And when you post the cap on the end of the pen, it does make this end of the pen a little heavy. Not sure where the balancing point is, right about there. That's where it balances. Then with a cap not posted, the pen balances right about the middle. I think I'm gonna write with it without it posted. And I'll try to zoom in just a little bit. And there we go. Jinhao 100. Fountain pen. Oh, my handwriting is not that good at the moment. This is kind of late in the evening that I'm making this video, and it's been a long day. If I had to describe the way it writes, one word that a lot of people use is juicy, meaning that the ink flows really well out of the nib. And it doesn't seem to have any problem keeping up. As far as flex goes, I can press lightly and get a little bit wider line on a downstroke than I can an upstroke or a side stroke. You don't want to press too hard, or sure enough, you'll knock the tines out of alignment. You don't want to do that. No, that would be bad. Very, very bad. Let me post it just to see how it feels. That's not bad. I could write with it like this. It skipped just a little bit right there. I meant to write main. I keep messing it up. I wished I had a remote control that I could just push off, you know, something off to the side to make my camera focused without me having to touch it. Because every time I touch the camera, it shakes. Whoops. I'm pretty happy with the way this writes. I guess it will only continue to get better as I use it. It's not bad at all. I'm really not trying to write neat. I'm trying to write quickly. Thank you. You know, it's really smooth. I do like this pen. And some of you know that I'm a big fan of italic nibs. Some people call them stub nibs. And though this is not an italic nib, I have an extra nib that is. Now, a stub nib tends to be kind of squared off on the end. That the width of that is how thick your line will be on a downstroke. But on a side stroke, it's going to be thin, pretty much like that. And that line variation makes for a very pleasing style of writing. And I can easily put this nib into this pen. And I do that on a lot of pens. You just kind of pull out the old one and push in the new one. But you can see the difference in these, I think. So that's the stub. And that's the regular stub, regular. The regular's kind of rounded. That's because it has a blob of iridium welded to it. It's pretty nice. I like it. Did I spell that right? Suzuki. Chainsaw? One word or two? Turn the plunger to make it go down just a hair. To make sure that the pressure is forcing ink toward the nib. because it occurred to me that when I drew the ink into the pen, the plunger was going up. And these days I like to finish it by making the plunger go down just a little and push the ink back toward the tip of the nib. So this Jinhao 100, I'm pretty pleased with it, so it's going to go into the rotation. I'm going to write with it for at least a couple of weeks, you know, just to see how it holds up. But yeah, it's pretty sweet. And it looks nice. And you can tell by looking at it that this pen was made, you know, these threads, the threads on this are not, I don't think they're molded. They look like they've been turned with a cutting tool, which is a plus. Instead of molded. Now the pen may be celluloid, which is a plus. But I can't tell, but the clip seems like it might be plastic. I'm sure this band is plastic. I mean, you have to make compromises. You know, if you had, you know, all these great metal parts and real gold and all that kind of stuff, you know, a pen like this might cost $500 or $600. So, but this doesn't cost anywhere near that. You know, pens like this are a great way to get into the hobby of fountain pens. You know, you can dip a toe into fountain pens. You don't have to buy the most expensive pens to get a pen that writes really well. And these are all great looking pens, and they're relatively inexpensive in the grand scheme of things. I mean, my dream pen is a Mont Blanc 149. I may never actually own one because they're so expensive. I think a pen like that is close to $1,000. But I do have a Jinhao 159. Which looks almost the same. It's approximately the same size. I mean, this pen cost hardly anything. I forget exactly how much it cost. I'll put it on the screen right now. Yeah, you can see that's a lot cheaper. A lot less expensive than a $950 Mont Blanc 149. Is the 149 a better pen? Yeah, I would say it's a better pen. I would say it's built with better materials. But would I say this is a bad pen? No. No, this is not a bad pen. It's definitely a value pen, as are all of these. This is my little focusing paper. I can put it right there. Or usually I hold it about this distance and tell my camera to focus on it, which it has. So I showed you a lot of pens in this video, and you probably have moved on if you were bored by my pace. Or you have fallen asleep by now. But if you're still awake, you can let me know in the comments that you stayed until the very end. By, oh, I don't know. You can type Dan Gurney rules. And he kind of did back in the day when it came to racing. So this pretty much wraps up this video. I appreciate you guys watching. And please consider subscribing. Leave me a like. Share it even, because that really, the YouTube algorithms recognize that. And it'll help my channel. So there's nothing wrong with me asking. So if you're so inclined, please do those things. Thanks for watching. Thank you.